Welcome to the STABcast, a podcast dedicated to Star Wars Legion.
But I'm sure he would have been proud of the army we've built for him.
The army?
Yes, a clone army, and I must say, one of the finest we've ever created.
Tell me, Prime Minister, when my master first contacted you about the army, did he say who it was for?
Of course he did. This army is for the Republic. But you must be anxious to inspect the units for yourself.
That's why I'm here.
Welcome, cadets and commanders, to STABcast. I'm Tim, worthless, wretched, awful, cruel, and misused, and horrible at this game, should retire, Hannon. With Ryan, didn't qualify Sawoski, Ben eliminated Fowler, and Will Heim is currently on assignment being a dutiful son and visiting his grandmother. How's everybody doing?
We're better than Will.
Yeah, I think we're all doing better than Tim. Like, that sounded like
that's true. You need to talk, buddy. Like, we can take this show down at a little bit different road if we need to get some feelings out.
My feelings will come out. It's fine. I've got notes on my feelings. It's fine. I'm ready for this.
We're just here for you, friend. I just want you to know, man.
This week on the STABcast, final Invader League standings, another Red Player's Dilemma, and much, much more.
Hold on. It's not the final Invader League standing. It's our final Invader League standing.
It's our final standing.
Listen,
there's
no
some
spoilers.
Other quality
We're
players
less than a
who, for
in.
Some
We're
reason,
less than a minute in.
No, well,
one reason Ryan. Or another, they let them keep playing.
Ryan, how is your single elimination game? Right.
So I cast a game. Yeah, I cast a game. That was fun.
Moving on. That's fine. I was going to say, so only Ben and myself have made it to the single elims. Let's rewind a moment here. And unfortunately, neither one of us made it past that moment. So okay.
Nope.
Brett don't. Also made it, but also did not make it past that moment. So now all of our hopes and dreams really lie with Bees, because he's the closest to a Knoxville player we have that's still in it.
Yep.
So now he's our champion.
He is... Not the reigning Knoxville Prime Champion, but he does carry our banner for winning our RPQ.
Correct.
But we did decide that Bees was definitely on the crack cocaine.
Yes.
Many of his comments during your game were...
Yes, many of his comments during my game were suspect. Incorrect, and I have now since messaged him, and I actually have notification from him right now. So that's what we were talking about, Aiden and her repeater, and how good it is versus how he doesn't believe in it, and how wrong he is about that. But anyway.
But he's still in the game, and you're out, right?
Yes, Ryan. He's still in the single elimination bracket that you never even made it into. So, yes.
Yeah. Got it.
So, okay. Here's the problem that both, I think, Brett, Tim, and I both encountered in the single eliminations. 1/3 of all the list were Republic.
Yeah. Just a little bit of a
100%
problem.
Win rate against Republic, yo.
My bracket, my round robin group only had one Republic in it, and it was Will. And I beat him black and blue. I just took him to town.
That's right.
So, yeah. It was going to be a problem. Tim knew his game was going to be a problem. We talked about it. We looked at it. Yeah. So, Tim, it was a problem.
It was a problem. In case it's not been stated enough. I played, and I'm going to get his username wrong. It's Quino? Yes. 75. His name's Bob. So we're just going to call him Bob. So I played Bob.
It's Australian for something. Like, Quino means something. Like, I don't know. It's Australian slang.
I didn't ask him. Yeah. I was busy crying. But anyway. So I played against Bob. He's from Western Australia. He was literally playing in a bus shack of the school he works at or something like that. And so on a Wi-Fi hotspot. No less. So this man is a champion in my book.
Yeah, absolutely.
And he was so friendly, absolutely wonderful. I can't give him enough compliments here. And he brought the clones. He brought just the standard kind of clone list here with I forget how many phase twos he had. It's nothing really crazy. It was the big note here is he had two arc snipers and one full arc squad, of course, with a sniper.
Yep.
So that's the big variation that you see sometimes of people messing around with that. And then just clones and Rex and R2.
Yeah, that's the format, the way that I've seen
it. Yeah, nothing super crazy, so I won't rehash.
That scared me the most.
Yeah, and rightfully so. Ha ha.
Overwatch everywhere. Overwatch.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Overwatch on a bunch of them. All that jazz.
Was there a Padme?
There was not a Padme. It was Rex R2, no Padme. Okay. Yeah. But anyway, and I had my list, which we've already talked about. Nothing super changed. Like I said, I took one RTC off for my round robin list and just dispensed those points with some extra scopes and things like that. Nothing too crazy. And we played on the Scarif map, which was great. Turn Zero was interesting. He was blue player. I believe he was 795. I could be wrong with that. He got blue player. We had our options were not stupendous for me, but not terrible initially. He had payload, key positions, intercept, advanced positions, battle lines, danger close, war weary, clear conditions, or supply drop. And that's what we had. Those are our options. We ended with, shamefully, I know, because this is basically a starter game.
Yeah,
clear, clear conditions, key positions, battle lines.
Okay, not the full starter game. That's I think Breakthrough is what it tells you to play out of the box.
Oh, is it? But, okay, yeah. Well,
but might as well be. Might as
well. Yeah, might as well be. I would love to have had Breakthrough. That would have been fantastic. But I really didn't want to play Intercept, and so because I just don't have good luck with Intercept. So I figured I could do a little bit better with key positions. Battle lines, yeah. Again, I think he 86'd advanced positions. And so then it was battle lines or danger close. And we talked about this before we started recording. I think I could have probably done danger close and been in a better situation. Yeah. But I wasn't sure. And again, the big theme for this game is... not enough
Tim's practice. Fear of the unknown.
Yeah, it's just not enough practice against clones. And so I didn't know.
And to give Kino credit, he did something that the chat, because I was watching this game, wasn't streaming it. I was in the chat channel the entire time.
Yeah.
And he did something that most of us were shocked about because he didn't play for the objective.
Yes. Yep. Yep.
And that I think threw everything off. And so the map balance felt uneven. As Tim was trying to react to that.
Yeah.
Well, and I think this is the cool powerhouse of that list, is this is one of the few like list archetypes that can do that. And then when you give them KP, it becomes real easy for them to just like score R2, turtle up, and win on points destroyed. Because you got to march into death.
Exactly. Well, and so in deployments, and of course, you know, in hindsight, it's 2020. But I thought about, as soon as we were deploying, I thought, okay, R2 is going to march across. I see his game plan. He wants to run him across the side of the board. The issue is, with clones rolling what they roll and how they roll, my fear was not so much that he would get the middle point, but the fear was that he would at least shoot me off of the middle point. And so I overcommitted a little bit to the middle because I was afraid he was going to push, and he was a very passive clone player, which for him, for this game, worked out just fine. I don't think it was a bad thing at all. And it allowed him to just focus on castling up around R2. Which is exactly what he was supposed to do. Right. And it was rough. And then I will say, going into turn one, I won't slow it down. Fortunately, we didn't go to all six turns, so you don't have to sit through all that, listeners. But turn one, I was also hoping, because he is a little bit of a newer player, he said, I was kind of hoping that he was going to shoot his load, so to speak, on take that clankers. Because of how his positioning was. And this is also streamed by Zyconia. So if anyone wants to go back and watch this, it was a very interesting game to watch. I'll say that, even as a losing player. Spoiler alert. But it was a very interesting game to watch. But I thought he was going to blow that and just take that clankers to get some shots on the dewback. And I was kind of okay with that because it was a good distraction. And then all his guys are in range of my guys to move into range 4 shots. He didn't. And that's a very good play on his part. He did not... take the bait, just like I didn't take the bait and get into range of take that clankers. So we both did a good job of kind of counterplaying that card, which when you're playing clones,
I don't know that Rex
moved
after he scouted.
He did a little bit, just very barely.
I mean, like
he did not move the shimmies for the aim tokens. Yep.
Yep.
That's exactly it.
Exactly it. And to make sure he was within sharing range of as many people as possible. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was just enough to trigger the it was gross.
Yeah, and then again, if you go back and watch it, you'll see that I moved my brown shores and really all my shores to the wrong point because I was afraid of a clone push against that point while R2 ran up the side and I would have to split my forces. but he didn't do that, and I had to overcorrect. There's a river in that map that was really troublesome for me because it slowed down my movement, and that was a huge factor as well. I could have been battle.
The river is probably just a couple of millimeters too wide.
Yeah, well, and
like it's
being battle.
You could accidentally not get across the entire time.
Well, being battle lines, I could have put more of my guys on the other side of it, but again, I was afraid of his push towards that point.
Right.
So I was trying to think ahead, and again, hindsight's 20/20, but that's okay. And some early hits on the shores also got me a little nervous, so I was kind of concerned about losing them, and I was trying to dodge the fire lanes of the arcs and trying not to get them just sitting out in the open, if at all possible. But anyway, so just fast forward, we're just moving around, nothing crazy, a couple of shots here and there. And then the arcs did a thing where they were able to move up and get a shot on the Dewback coming in from behind cover. And he wasn't behind perfect, like, line of sight blocking cover. And then they got a shot in. I rolled 6 red dice. 4 of those 6 were blank, and one of my blocks was pierced. So Dewback in one shot took 5 damage, which was not great.
And you had heavy cover.
I had heavy cover.
No, yeah, heavy down the light.
No. I had...
Did you not?
No cover.
Yeah, you did.
No, I did not.
No cover. Yeah. Okay.
No cover.
Dewbacks and Tons are, depending on who you're playing with, right, can vary on CTS,
yeah,
are theoretically very hard to give cover to because the barricades do not give them cover. Correct. So.
Yeah. So, and even the barricade was only light anyway, so it would have been sharpshooted down regardless. But I had the armor, so that's why I got rid of 1 in there, but still 6 coming through. So anyway, so 5 damage come through, Dewbacks on 1 health, and I do see... The chat was quite like, oh, that Dewback's dead, ha ha ha. People always underestimate Spur. Like, Spur with that base is a good distance. And so I said, okay, I needed him to have a few more health, but 1 health isn't the end of the world. And so I just charged in and engaged those arcs, rolled 4 hits on him, which isn't great, but I couldn't take an aim because then the Dewback would have been dead. Only 4 hits, and he rolls 4 blocks. So, for those that are keeping score, I had blanked almost on my dice. So, I had 4 blanks, and then he had 4 blocks. It's great. This was right after he had rolled double crits naturally with his arcs, which he would then go on to do again.
This is when it becomes a Tim battle report, when we have a nice tactics talk.
Well, I'm not alone, because if you go through the chat, everyone will validate me. That's fine. But so, Ryan can harp against me if he wants to, but it's fine.
I did watch this game, and I was there the entire time, and there's a good strategy for the Dewback rushing out, grabbing those arcs, punching them in the head, and then getting close enough to either go punch R2 with his meaty claws.
Yes, that was the plan.
I mean, it's a valid strategy. Like, it's a distraction, and it's the right distraction, and the dice did absolutely desert you. They did.
Yeah,
it was hard. Now, Tim is going to make a lot of mistakes after the dice desert you. Yes, absolutely. He's going to make a ton of mistakes.
The game was over at that point anyway, so it's okay.
See, this is where I disagree. I have faith that you could have pulled it back.
But, no. And but so all that happens, and then Aiden gets shot. She was in the open. There's only 1 unit, I think, that could shoot her, and I was thinking this is in turn 3. So fast forward to turn 3. My plan had been for the Dewback, honestly, to actually die. His arcs go first, kill the Dewback with 1 health. They've then activated. Aiden has her blast gun with the scatter. So shoot those arcs, scatter them forward so that the shores can mop them up, and hopefully, just kill them outright, and then be good. Unfortunately, and everyone in chat is like, oh, this is great, he pulled his Dewback first. That's actually not what I wanted at all. It was the opposite of what I wanted. And so that happened, and I had to take Dewback first, and I was measuring, trying to figure out if I could do it. I was just shy of a withdraw into another Z6 squad, which is what I was hoping for, but I was just shy of it. So I said, okay, we'll aim and punch. And it was not great. It was not a super effective punch. Got a few units off the board, but not nearly enough because it was a full health arc squad. So not enough.
I think they blocked 1 or 2 of
them.
I mean, yeah.
And then, so this is very much a case, everyone, forest for the trees. I saw those arcs. I was concerned about those arcs, which is why Aiden was where she was. Aiden was also trying to dodge standby tokens, because if she got too close, she was going to set off a standby and just get murdered. But I was so focused on those arcs, I didn't realize that the phase 2s or whatever could just hop the fence and shoot me with a double Z6 fire support shot. Yeah.
And that's exactly what happened.
Exactly what happened. And she should have lived, but not when he rolls 5 crits naturally.
And so let me set the scene for this. It's Sicily, 1920. There's it is a single unit leader with a Z6, which Tim had been working on from a distance. Like, he was getting work done there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It had a token. A full phase 2 squad hops forward, gets within range so they can do the fire support. Mm-hmm. It is 17 dice. Yes. It is 12 white dice. It is 5 black dice.
Yes.
All right, 17 dice. Now, that's a lot of dice, but it's also a lot of white dice. It is 12 white dice. As a man who throws, 7 white dice and 3 black dice, that can sometimes just be a single hit, if you're lucky. Right. Tim, how many hits actually happened?
That's 12.
12, 12
it was 12. There. By the time we're all said and done, it was 12.
5 natural crits.
Yeah.
5 natural crits happened right there.
Yep. On white dice, mostly. Mostly white dice.
On white dice.
Which I understand crit chance is the same on all dice, but still, you'd like white dice to be blank. They were not blank.
Now, again, to Kino's credit, because of the list and because of the structure of clones, he had 11 surge tokens to spend that turn.
Yep, there it is.
Between the phase twos, he spent all of them.
Between that attack
between
and the
phase twos, aggressive tactics, and in Rex's command card, he just had all of them.
It was gross. So yes.
And he rolled enough paint to be able to use, I think, 9 on that attack.
So that was rough. So Aiden was only in light cover. She had no suppression on her. And again, she really just needed to take one shot, and then her job was just going to be hide, wait for R2, and just spring the trap on R2. And she couldn't really do that. We rolled.
Right.
And she went down from full health with the shield bot boy to 1 health only. And I will say, full disclaimer here, if you go back and watch, we misplayed shield. Because both of us were so blown away by that roll that we just weren't thinking. And so we both misplayed. I rolled and then took a shield away. I shouldn't have done that. But again, it was so bad.
Oh, I see.
Well, I don't think he wanted me to re-roll that. So that's good. So I
Didn't. That's and when you roll too many dice, which you did in that instance,
right.
you re-roll the pool. So
right, exactly. That's what I'm saying.
Hang on. But the pool itself, though, was 4 blocks.
Yes.
5 surges.
Yes.
And 2 blanks.
Yes.
Now, granted, that's actually a really good roll. So
that's actually a really good roll.
If you surge on defense,
anybody.
It's great.
If you have block, if you're a Grievous with a dodge token, that's a great roll.
Yeah.
If you're a Luke with deflect, you've wiped out whole squads of human beings.
Yeah.
With that deflect.
Oh, that's great. It's great for anything that has anything to do with surges.
But Aiden doesn't do any of that.
Aiden does not. That's correct.
So a surge is as good as a blank.
Yeah. And she had a dodge token, she did not have a dodge token at that point, sorry. And it was rough. So she went down to 1 health, and then she hid, and she ended up getting taken out. And so that whole flank disappeared, and between that and then also which is 100%, this is not dice, this is me misplaying. I put the shores towards the middle too far, because again, I was afraid of a counterattack, and it was trying to respond too little too late. I couldn't do enough. Dubek died. Aiden died. Everything died. Mortar becomes a commander. Long story short, R2 is running up there. He's about to score. And I had the shores finally in a position. They were whittled down, but they could shoot him. And he had no suppression on him. And R2 did have, I think, a wound on him. I might have gotten one through at some point.
Yeah, I think you got one through.
Yeah, I think I got one through. Yeah. So there was a chance of shooting him. And then, I think it was turn 5, he plays, is it Blast Off? Yeah. The 1 pip. The 1 pip for R2, which I did not expect. I did not see that coming at all. And I think I played Ambush, and it wasn't enough. Because, again, R2 gets a suppression and a dodge, which means I can't shoot him. I had other targets, mm-hmm. and because I had other targets... There was no way for me to wipe out those other targets and still kill.
Yeah, he did a really good job of putting a bunch of units and activating in the right order to make sure you couldn't like terrain scope or range scope R2. Yeah.
Yes, which I was trying to
say. Part of it is the board helped him with that because that side is wide open.
Yes.
On your side of the board in that corner is wide open. There's not a lot of cover except for those trees.
Yeah.
And he was in the trees.
Yep. Which is hilarious when you say that, man, this board really helped him because it was wide open.
Yeah. But it did because his clones could hide behind these barricades and this big giant building.
Yeah.
And Tim was left in a place where to get to range three was going to put him in the open.
Yeah. And it's the problem was, again, with R2, there's just too many things for them to shoot. And they didn't have enough. If they were full health squads, we could have killed them and then still gotten a shot on R2. But we just couldn't do it with what was there. Because his whole game plan at that point is not even to kill me, just to keep moving bodies to block R2. And that's it. And he could easily do that. So we called it after that.
One of the ways I think, because I caught the back half of this game. Mm-hmm. One of the ways I think it got away from you. When did you realize his plan was to just turtle on one KP?
Pretty much from the beginning. Like once,
but say, after deployment,
After deployment, I'd say probably at round 2.5. I was like, okay, he's not even trying to push this point.
And yeah, that's two and a half is a good little ways into the game, though.
Right,
and
exactly. So, like,
kudos to him for keeping that on the DL, and then
And like I said, that's when you'll see
a good learning experience for you. Yeah,
if you watch the game, you'll see my shores suddenly do an about face and be like, we got to run the other way.
Yeah.
And again, because I will say, chat definitely, we saw it because we're looking at the way the board's set up, and we're like, oh, he's not even going to attempt to combat the center point.
Right.
Which is so odd for KP. Normally, that's where the death battle happens.
Right.
He's like, nope, I'm just going to ignore it. And I get Tim was very worried about if a unit gets just shot off there, if he loses bodies and now he just can't put another unit on the center point, that's a real issue.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. But the problem is there are so many units on the center. Yeah. You just didn't have enough time to get them over to shoot R2.
Yeah. And again, a lot of my mistakes were, looking back on it, you're like, oh yeah, he made that mistake. But it's very much a hindsight issue where I didn't know that was going to be his game plan. He was very conservative and I didn't expect that. And so very easy to see. I know some people have said if he had pushed the middle, he could have wiped me off the middle. I politely disagree with that, but I see what they're saying.
I disagree with that too. There was a lot of chat. If you go watch the video, like, well, if he'd just gone in the middle and then done clone stuff in the middle, how gross would that have been?
No.
Except that means all of his units are also getting shot at by your guys.
If you look at the map and look at terrain, he would have been way too open.
He would have been a lot more exposed.
He would have been way too open. I was kind of hoping he would do that, and he didn't.
Now, not to say that he couldn't do it, but he definitely played it safe the way he did.
I think it's still...
Now, if you want to watch how not to play bikes, watch Tim play bikes in this game.
Hold on. After my other guys had died, so I was absolutely tilted, so I wasn't paying enough attention. I didn't see that Pink Squad had not activated yet, and so I moved them in. I knew they were going to take a standby shot. I was like, we can take one shot. First off, 5 dice in, 5 blanks. So that's great. White dice being white dice.
Nearly dead.
And then we couldn't even get a shot back through. I got, one hit on black, red, white, surging the hit. One hit, and it was in heavy cover, so it didn't matter. And it was rough. It was just rough. And then the pink squad just went again and just annihilated the bikes, and then my other bikes died, and it was not good. Definitely not my best bike play, for sure. Like,
right.
I think I posted a link to a GIF that was just tilt, 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 like nine times in that chat.
No, it's accurate. It's absolutely accurate. But again, at that point, I'd already kind of given up. And I was like, all right, this is just going to be, I don't think I'm going to have the bodies to take him out. Because also chat was saying, like, well, why doesn't he just run his bikes to go shoot R2? Dear listeners, again, I encourage you to go back and watch this game. If I did that, my bikes are flying in front of the entire clone army. They don't survive that encounter. They don't get far enough to kill R2. They just die.
In defense of the listener, they did just die.
Yeah, exactly. But
they smashed themselves up one by one on the wall that was the clone.
Yeah. So. And also, some of those, I didn't realize with that terrain, I could have gone on top of a rock, which is a really tall, spiry rock, so I didn't think I could go on top of it. It was only height 1. I could have jumped on top. Didn't think about that, so I didn't play that correctly, but didn't realize that. That's on me. But it's definitely some mistakes on my part that a lot of it came down to, I didn't see that coming. Okay.
So Tim's opponent, Kino, is a super nice guy.
Yeah, absolutely.
Incredibly nice guy. And he offered to come on to the podcast today to talk about his game with Tim.
Good old Bob.
Yep.
Bob.
I politely decline because I'm like, I don't know that Tim can handle that.
I don't think I can.
It's not because of you, Bob.
Yeah.
It's because Tim's an asshole.
That's right.
We didn't want to trigger him again, and I would have loved to have a conversation with you about Tim's many failings.
Well,
but
and so
for the sake of Tim's health.
What's funny too is in the after the action report, right? Like the interview after the game, I did say probably my most dickish comment I've ever said on a stream, but I was so angry at that point. Yeah. I didn't give a and I still don't, but that's not true. I do now. I feel bad for saying it, but I said,
but you're going to repeat it here. You feel so bad. You're going to repeat it here.
It was a ballsy play and you got lucky.
Would you like to retract that statement?
No, because it was a ballsy play and he got lucky. But still.
No, that was that's the right way to play his list against yours.
It is the right way to play, but it's still ballsy.
And I will say, because we knew the clone ball was coming. We knew the clone standby with the offensive push and the Overwatch was a thing that was coming.
Yep.
And Tim and I both planned for it. And then Kino took it that one step farther. It's like, I'm not going to play the objective game like you think.
Correct.
And that did throw things off. Like, it was a masterful play. I've got to say.
It was very well. And yeah, all joking aside, it was ballsy, but also I made some very big misplays. And he made some great plays. So I wanted to
start from that. I mean, if you can keep your win condition guised from your opponent for, like you said, 2.5 rounds, like, that's a hard game to lose at that point if your opponent's playing the wrong game, especially if you're in the driver's seat. So, you know.
And he did compliment me after the game. He's like, thank you for not, like, totally – because verbally I didn't totally tilt on him and just start yelling at him, and, like, I didn't get nasty with him or anything like that. He's like, thank you for not being too salty. I was like, you don't understand how salty I am right now, but that's fine. But I'm not going to take it out on you because you're a very nice person, and he's a very wonderful player, did a great job playing. And I was like, we're just going
to
sit
back and
rock.
You know, your wife is a nurse. I would love to get you hooked up to some monitors as we're doing this. Like, I need O2 consumption. I need blood pressure ratings.
I just need the heart rate and blood pressure.
Well, so side note, funny you say that. I was looking at my heart rate monitor thing, like, because it's on my watch. And I noticed, going back in my history, some really heavy spikes to where it started, like, alerting me. Saying, like, hey, your BP's...
Are you okay, buddy?
Or not your BP. Your heart rate is 131. Are you okay? That was LVO. It was an It was an LVO. Yeah, I spiked a few times in LVO.
So, Tim plays his game on Friday night,
yes,
meaning that his kind Australian opponent is playing at like 7 a.m. Australian time.
Yes.
Now, Australian West Coast time.
8 a.m., right. But yes.
So, my opponent was James Brett, another fabulous Australian. He's on the Eastern time zone. So, there's like a 14-hour difference between the two of us. I happen to have been off. I've actually started my summer break as a school teacher. It's not very long because of my job now. So I was like, you know what? I will get up early. I will be kind to the Australian. I'll let him play in his nighttime. I will get up at 5:30 a.m. Yeah,
Look at us setting up the excuses right before we even get into the game.
I was being quite kind to my opponent. No. Part of it, I always feel bad for the Australian players. They're put into brackets where they end up playing people they know because of the time zone issue.
Yeah, and then it's such a small pool of players.
It's a small pool of players.
Which actually, I do want to address that for a second. It is a small pool of players, but for the relative populations of, like, North America getting 23 brackets, and then Australia had, what, 5?
Yeah.
And, like, the population difference, like, good on you guys for having a high turnout.
Yeah, absolutely. And good players, too. Like, really good.
Yeah, they're very good players.
All my comments aside, my player, he did a great job. Very, very solid.
Yes.
Very solid.
And now I'm not going to say it's collusion on the bracket maker's part, but all the Australians were in what we call the fourth quarter bracket. And so all the Australians are in that group, and Tim and Brett and I are all in that bracket as well. Yeah. I'm not saying collusion.
It's Thrawn's fault. Collusion. That's fine. I'm fine with blaming Thrawn.
That's fine.
And all the Australians, I think only one grouping was Australian v Australian. So there was a lot of trying to figure out that time zone for us to play.
Right.
Now, my opponent is James Brett, a man whose last name is Brett, which is also the same name as the Archenemy of the podcast. I did not hold that against him, though, because he was so cool. He's a very nice guy. All the Australians I've watched play, I've listened to them talk, they're great. So,
right.
If you have a fear of playing Legion in Australia, you shouldn't. You should definitely go. Find those guys out. Play them online. I will say I had to change my list. I knew my list would probably be okay. My first list was like, let's go play with some BXs. It was a lot of fun. And then when I looked at my group makeup, I kept that list through the round robin. I knew I could survive with that list. I knew it would not survive single eliminations. Right. So I had to change it. And so I went with a rainbow B1 setup, which is not me. You know, I like to have my consistency and every unit's roughly the same. I did go back to Grievous Aggressive Tactics, Strict Orders Endurance.
Yep.
With the gun. I had a naked B1 squad. I had a B1 with the Rocket Boys. I had a two B1 sniper squads. The B1 E5S that shoots the red, white with the critical one. A set of B2 supers with an extra body and the ACM 3 red dice guy. And a B1 with the E5C battle droid in the HQ uplink.
Yeah.
Now, and also on top of that, I had 3 STAPs with command control arrays.
Oh, I like the STAPs though. I think STAPs are.
You had
decent.
Command controls arrays on all of them?
I did.
Oof.
It's a bold statement, sir.
Yeah, I don't know about that.
So the goal was, because normally the way I can always arrange it is kind of like in a U shape. And if I can at least keep the leading STAP in range, I can bounce far enough around to get back into my droid bodies. Okay. Or bounce it to 2 of the 3, and the other one's the only thing left in the bag. Him or Grievous. Like, I can kind of make those kind of plans. It was one of those, I struggled. You'll notice that I had no extra bodies on these droids, and I have a right. naked B1 squad. It was to get that extra STAP. Mm-hmm. I originally had a list where I had dropped one of those activations, but activation count is so important.
Yep.
And I had to get as many as I could, and it was well worth it in this game.
Yeah.
It allowed me to do a lot more things than I think was possible. And it kept me in the game. There was a chance I pulled the win after a pretty disastrous round one. So, of course, no one's awake for this. I think Tim finally wakes up, has a cup of coffee. He watches a little bit on his way to work. Kingsley does stream this, by the way. So if you go to Tower Number 9 on Twitch, you can watch this game. He got up early and we had quite a few viewers. I think 64 viewers, I think, throughout the show. So that's not bad.
That's pretty solid for a Legion stream.
Yeah.
Now,
woke up to watch your shamble of a game.
Because it was a good game, sir. You weren't awake, but it was a good game.
No, I'm never awake.
So my opponent, what is he playing? The Republic. It's Rex. It's 3 ARC snipers. It's phase 2s and phase 1s with all the things you're supposed to have on them and Z6s and a saber tank. Yeah, he's one of the few players with a saber tank from the Republic. And I don't know if that hurt me or helped me. It right. means there are less phase 1s on the table, right. but I probably would have been okay. we're playing hostage exchange, fortified positions, and danger close. And oh, was it danger so very close on my end? So I will say I got very lucky. War Weary was in the first column, so I could get rid of it.
Mm.
He got rid of disarray, and I'm not real sure why. I think he was afraid of the hostage being able to go to another corner. Like, it opened up too many options for the hostage to come into. And so I think he got rid of disarray for that. And then the second thing I got rid of was clear conditions, because I am no Tim.
Oh.
Listeners, I am no Tim. So I went with 4-5 positions, thinking that it would help me.
Did it help you?
A little bit. It didn't help as much as I would have liked. Turns out tanks are really tall and can see over most barricades.
Yeah.
Especially from a long range.
It's true.
All right. So we set mostly, and we take the center points of danger close. Like, we're trying to get as close as we can to the center point. He puts his tank on my side of the board. I put a single STAP on his side of the board because that's where R2 is.
Mm.
And so I'm able to activation control, and I have one more activation than him to start, that I can make sure that STAP moves last and then moves first, which is exactly what I end up doing with it.
Right.
The problem is round one was real rough on me. That tank I see is bearing down. So I am trying to move all of my units from my line edge into all the cover that exists in the middle of the Scarif board. Like, I've got to get them out of shots of this tank.
Right.
And the tank rumbles forward. I'm like, okay, most of the guys were in cover by that point. Like, if I lose some people, it's not going to be that terrible. Grievous, his base is right on the edge of range 4. Hmm. Like, just barely scrapes it. And I don't know that I could have planned it any better. Like, Grievous went exactly where he had to go. I could have moved it slightly enough to get him out had I realized that's exactly how far. But I would have had to measure everything out exactly to make sure that was going to work. And right. so he takes a shot. He puts 4 wounds on him at range 4 in turn 1.
Yep, I saw
nothing
it.
Nothing I can do about it.
Saw it happen.
I mean, nothing I can do about it. I rolled blanks. I'm like, well, there's a thing. And then because ARC troopers can do what ARC troopers do, they're at range 5. And so they snipe. They put 2 more on him. Grievous has 6 wounds at the end of turn 1.
Gross.
It is absolutely the grossest thing. So I'm thinking that, like, okay, well, this game is just about over.
Yep.
My B2s are my hostage carriers, and thank God I had them, because they had enough health, and the armor meant they soaked up shots for 4 rounds before they finally died. I never shoot with my B2s.
Now you just run.
Okay.
I just had to run. I just had to run.
That's
and the
right.
problem is the tank is bearing down on my closest exit to get to within my zone. Like, there's no way for me to go that way. The tank is just going to blow them up on that side.
Right.
So I have to run back to the other side of Danger Close. And it is a very gross piece here. So end of round one, Grievous is on 6 wounds, but I have a staff that is ready to go in and shoot R2-D2 in the face. Start of round two, I make sure that the only token in my bag is a staff. I pull the staff. I shoot R2-D2 in the face, and he explodes. One shot.
Huzzah! Kill the droid. We hate him.
Things Tim is incapable of.
I will tell you that in every game in which R2-D2 appeared against me, I killed him. Every time. If he showed up on the table, he was a dead man. in part because you just can't play around with those points. Especially with hostage. The game is a 2-point game one way or the other. You can't afford to have that extra one hanging out there.
That's correct.
No, it's a 4-point game.
You can get more than one point. Yeah, but in going against the clones, I can't get droids into his deployment zone to pick up his hostage and take it back to mine. There's not enough turns nor life points in that.
Yeah, I don't know that. And I know, once again, you don't have the option. Hostage exchange as a CIS player gives me a little bit of worry.
In what way?
Well, the things that army seems to be really good at doing, I don't think starting a unit really far forward and then marching a unit really far backwards is really what that army wants to do.
Oh, no, it's not what we want to do at all. But had he not had the tank, I think I would have been fine. Hmm. There's enough cover to block line of sight. I can probably survive it. The tank was a thing that was forcing my guys to not be able to run backwards that way. I had to run across the long way of the map to get back into a deployment zone. And that's ultimately what's going to cost me the extra point.
Right.
I just can't get there because I had to juke around because the tank has shots. The arcs had shots. So round two is happening. Because I have more activations, I'm able to control when Grievous goes. So I have him in a hiding spot, like he's surviving, and I'm able to control that setup. I get Grievous into the middle to do Grievous things, which is basically try to attack as many things as possible. I've been shooting Rex so much so that he has to take a recover action in case he panics. Like I'm not doing damage, but I am putting the suppression out there. I'm wasting Rex's turns.
Mm-hmm.
I have a mediocre Grievous. One pip. Like, it just, everything doesn't go as well as it probably should. I don't clean up all the units that I probably should.
Right.
It's just mediocre dice. I mean, and those are things that happen. I plan it out exactly right, but then I am just shedding robot bodies. Like, I'm doing lots of damage. I'm not killing enough of his. There's a lot of one unit leader kind of things floating around still. Even on my side, there's a lot of one unit leaders kind of floating around. Mm-hmm. And I cannot get damage into the arcs to save my life. I never use the rocket on the tank. I never shoot the tank. It's never worthwhile unless you just have the opportunity. It's going to be set up correctly.
Right. Yeah.
It just, so the rocket boy, actually, I would just refresh and shoot again, refresh and shoot again. But yeah, so when it comes down to it, I do the best I can against it. I have a disastrous clankers again, because that map and the setup.
Yeah, it was rough.
Clankers from his position can shoot right across the middle there.
Yep.
Staps are kind of required to go in, and with a standby ball. there's no real place that I can do my mandatory 3-speed without triggering it in some way or the other.
Sure.
Right.
I'm too tall, so they always have line of sight. And again, the problem, I don't know if it's a problem with standby, but one of the issues with that is standby can be used against anybody. It doesn't have to be the guy who moved. So I'm going to trigger it no matter what. So I lost an entire STAP unit in a standby move. Like, I moved into their standby range, thought I could survive it, and didn't. It just, the dice were against me. The white dice were all blank. And I lost an entire squad before they can do anything.
Yep.
So I just want to point out a bit of irony here. You know, 3 months ago, the clones, I definitely think we can all agree, were on the struggle bus.
Mm-hmm.
And granted, yes, they do have a whole bunch of releases in Invader League that we won't have physical copies of for another 2 to 3 months.
Ever.
well, I mean, maybe.
Not if Tim has his way. He's going to set them all on fire.
Maybe. But also, the standby action was, even once Republic came out, was a bit of a joke action. Really, until Phase 2s came out, and then even then, it was still somewhat of a corner case. Not like it is on TTS now. And I just think that's funny how quickly we've had that huge turnaround.
Yeah. Well, that's the nice thing about Legion, too, right? Is, like, with a few things coming out, a couple of releases, the whole game can shift. Everything can shift. Right. Which is always good, because if you're ever frustrated with where this game is at, it's easily fixable. And sometimes it's not even like a hard fix. It's just wait for this new unit to come out, and that'll help you.
Wait a couple months.
Yeah.
That's a dangerous place to be, though. At least the way you worded it. Like,
no, I love it.
Power creep scares me because then the meta is just defined by whatever's new and hot, and you got to buy the new things, and then each faction's only got a couple of different armies that are all have similar focuses.
Maybe. I mean, but we're talking about, I mean, not to rewind all the way, but we talk about Hask coming out and putting him on some, or Del or whoever his face is, and putting him on some snows.
Oh, and I get that, and I think that's going to be, yeah, but it's still like a new coat of paint on the old unit. I'm hopeful for just the end of the year errata whenever that comes, and that's why I'm trying not to come down too hard one way or another, because, you know, until things are released in print, how to phrase what I'm trying to say here, I don't think FFG cares about their balance as it goes to the TTS League, because they're going to put stuff in their game whenever they want
TTS to. TTS doesn't exist, Ryan. What are you talking about?
Right, exactly.
Yeah. that's the thing.
And so, like, I don't want to judge the power of units or whatever until we actually get them in print and get chances to play them against what the designers
I'll judge it hard.
So Ryan and Tim and I have been having this debate for the past week, and sometimes to a heightened degree, in which there may be lots of memes that are very not nice to one another. Because I am one of those people that think TTS sometimes allows us to see a little too far in the future.
Yeah.
And we proclaim units to be dead before they get there. But this year of the COVID has been so odd for releases. That's fair. I mean, like, my tank was delayed almost 2 full months. It has yet to see table play because it didn't exist until 2 weeks ago.
Right.
Like,
right.
I did not get a physical copy till two weeks ago. So we've got units that are out of sync. And that, my fear of, well, the devs know that this unit will be popular for a month until this other unit comes out, and that balances things. The setup is now mixed up enough. I don't know that we'll ever achieve that until well after this thing is resolved. Till next year, probably. That being said, yes, clones became very good because you had not only the having the phase ones and the phase twos and all those ideas. You also got Padme, and you also got the arcs.
Yep.
And you also got everyone sleeping on that ATRT. That ATRT is so good.
Oh, it's so good.
This goes back to what we were talking about. The arcs are so good that people then disappeared and stopped talking about the ATRTs.
Yeah.
Which can take a standby token.
It can take standbys. I mean, it can't share them yet.
Exactly.
But it's also like, show me a vehicle that has scout. And like, the problem with the Rebel ATRT is that it takes a turn or two to really get it where you need it to. But if you could just scout that huge base, heck yeah, man. Like,
it surges on defense. And it has a better offhand gun.
Yeah.
It's a black white. Like, it's a legit
critical one. Yeah. So you're not even really missing the surge crit, at least with the main gun.
Exactly.
I would take it in a heartbeat. A naked clone ATRT is a fantastic weapon.
Yeah.
And I do think TTS is sleeping on it. But they're sleeping on it because the ARC full team or the ARC strike team is so good.
They're so good, and then there's not, we haven't figured out the best way to deal with it yet.
Panic.
Yeah.
Panic at the disco.
But you got to build suppression lists. You got to build in that direction. And it's hard. The ARCs being able to walk forward, because they play like a sniper team you've never seen, which is, I'm going to hide a guy and never move. The ARCs don't care. They're going to walk forward because they want that aim token. They want to be close enough to their brethren to pick up their green tokens.
Yeah.
And a full team is what? We said 110 points?
Yep.
Something like that.
Which is a great value for the things that it does and how it does it. The 10-point jetpack, which you don't have to put on it, I think is just sweet, sweet icing on that cake.
Well, and the other cool thing the jetpack did is when they did the rules update, when that thing was, you know, kind of spoiled or out, that units that have multiple models in them, if they have the jump keyword, can be on different levels for cohesion.
Mm-hmm.
Which is also, again, fantastic, because sometimes your terrain doesn't allow you to put five guys on top of a
table. That's true.
But then they also did have Padme. And I know neither Tim's list or the one I played against had Padme.
I got to play a Padme in round robin. It's obnoxious.
It's
she just stands there and, like, quick thinking standby. Good luck.
Yep. I order Padme.
And she gives a surge token. She generates a surge every round. So just like, here's four tokens that anyone who needs them can spend.
Or if you don't do that, then she's like, I've got secret mission. I'm going to just slowly walk up here behind this gated fence of, you know, clones.
Correct.
And yeah.
Step in your zone and like tap.
I think the reliable is so much stronger, unless you want to run like a double secret mission comp. like this highly mobile secret mission.
And that's the one I saw was a secret mission for R2 and for Padme. In a game where you've got a 4-point swing from, you know, 4-0 or 2-2,
mm-hmm.
I mean, those two extras, that makes a huge difference.
That can make a huge difference, yeah.
I mean, KP only has 3 victory points, and if you can get 2 of them on characters.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a... It is a very, 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 very big deal there.
All right. So here's the answer to the clone standby ball. I play secret mission R2-D2 as a rebel and a naked X-34. And I just put R2 without 3PO in the X-34. Just
GTFO. What? Hop and out. Get the secret mission. Hop back in.
Fix the thing when it gets shot at because you're trying to kill R2.
but you have to hop out of the vehicle to fix it.
Because you can't
use your keywords.
Yeah.
Maybe.
This is the new meta. This is the new meta.
Oh, God. I'm going to build it. No, thank you.
To get back to the main conversation there, I see the worry with TTS. And this is something that, you know, and it is one of the reasons why Ryan, I don't think, plays TTS that often.
Yeah, it is.
And it is a reason why I have hesitations with it. I do sometimes think the meta, quote unquote, is shaped by podcasts like us who talk about these things. And the people who play it, they're very good. I mean, mm-hmm. the Discord community other podcasts, is very not good. Us,
but...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, right. Clearly, we're not. No. Yeah, we've already discussed that.
No. What I mean is the Discord community is very good, but their opinions are also very strong. And I don't necessarily know that I agree with them on all things.
Yeah, I think at some points, not all the time, but at some points it can create an unhealthy echo chamber.
Yes. In fact, we're laughing about talking to Bees. It's because Tim was rewatching his game, reading the comments, and there's like, Bees is on crack here. What are you talking about? So we messaged him saying, listen, this is crazy town. There are people that I was like, why are you saying that? And this is me in chat. Like, that's not how play happens in real life. Maybe that's how that happens here on this particular TTS.
Mm-hmm.
But we travel enough that we know that's not how people in the wild actually play.
That's people in the wild. That's right.
We know the TTS ecosystem is a different beast than the actual live play. And so you have to think about those things when making, you know, when talking about the impact of a piece and the piece.
Sure, out there.
Oh, yeah.
We really could not use Cad Bane because we had not seen enough of his cards before this tournament started.
Right. Or had it, and then once you had them, had enough time to practice with them.
Well, I played 3BXs having never actually played BX, and loved it. So I would have put Cad Bane on the table if I'd had full access to all his cards.
Right.
But as they existed, the things we had weren't enough to make him worthwhile to play. It was a point sink I just didn't think I could spare.
Sure.
Because for the cost of him, I got 2BXs.
But that's all the Legion really get to experiment with, as slowly but surely, slowly things are kind of opening, maybe closing back down. I don't know. We'll see.
Tennessee's getting ready to come down real hard again.
Yeah, I know. Right. I see. I actually just saw that on my phone while we were talking.
I saw this week Tim breaking, you know, the Stabcast quarantine and going and playing some games. I'm like,
I did.
Son of a bitch.
I couldn't keep it in anymore. I had to get out of here.
I went to the game store to buy a model because they had come in. I bought Cassian Andor and I bought Iden Versio, you know, because I still keep that collection going in case I ever burn my robots. I like painting them. I like having them. I also like being able to share them out when people want them.
Yeah.
And so while I was there, I saw people playing, but I'm wearing a mask and they're all having a great time and they understood it, but they also knew why I wasn't coming out anytime soon. So
in the midst of all those things, what have y'all been doing?
Like, obviously, I don't have a battle report.
That's why
I don't play on TTS that much. Yeah. I've been playing a ton of RPGs online, tabletop RPGs on online. I'm both in a Star Wars game and GMing a Star Wars game. I'm in a 5th edition game and I'm running a 5th edition game. So like some weeks I'm just like playing four-hour RPGs a week. And so that's been keeping me pretty busy. So yeah, nice. It's been fun. It's been enjoyable. Check out Recover the Supplies on Fifth Trooper Network.
This is where Will would chime in and say he's been painting things, but
he has been painting things. Yeah. My problem is he hasn't been painting my things.
It's because
a reckoning.
That's because you guys all went and you quit on me. I mean, I'm playing RPGs, but at least they're Star Wars RPGs. You guys are playing a different minis game now. Come on.
All I'm saying.
What are we, the fifth trooper? Jumping ship as soon as stuff gets hard for Legion? Like, come on. We're not freaking Shalansky here.
Before Tim's loss, he was already thinking about this.
That's
true. He texted me. I was like, oh, Tim, don't do it. Don't do it, Tim. And then after his loss, he legitimately said on stream, I'm quitting this game. I'm going to go play Warhammer.
And so
what'd you do, Tim?
Well, now I have a Chaos Army, so that's fun for Age of Sigmar. So that's neat. What a good time. I'm painting them. I'm still playing Legion, though. I've played several games since then, so that's okay. But also playing some Warcry. Our local place has a slow grow Warcry League, so eventually it'll grow into full Age of Sigmar, which is good for learning a new system, I think, is it'll help me get used to like a D6. Oh, I roll 20 D6s? Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I mean, that's always been the Warhammer joke between us. It's like, oh, look, I'm going to roll dice to see how many dice I roll, and you had the initiative, so all your dice go first, and now I'm dead. Good game, sir. We spent 2 hours setting up. The game lasted 14 minutes. Which is, by the way, how I describe Tim's sex life.
Oh.
Somebody. I will say, I also have bought into this Warcry.
There you
for
go.
A slightly different reason. I did. I admitted to Ryan last night. I felt very ashamed of myself.
Yeah, so they did this on the DL without telling me, the listener, by the way.
Because we know all you would do is criticize us and yell at us, so therefore, why bother?
Yeah, which is why we're here right now. So, right, dear listeners, if you want to help me, send all your hate mail to swstabcast@gmail.com.
I've talked about this before, that our game store, the one we normally play at, is about a 35 to 40 minute drive for me.
Right.
True. Like, it is on the far side of town, and I love them, and I will continue to support them. Another game store has popped up 8 minutes from my house. The problem is, they have absolutely nothing that I'm going to buy. And it's mostly they're a D&D shop, they're very much a Warhammer shop, they're a magic shop. And none of those are things that I'm playing.
Yeah.
Nowadays. And so I was like, I've got to give money, because I'm one of those believers. You pay to play at your local store. A friendly local game store is the best investment you can make.
Right.
And because his store opened right as the COVID shutdown came.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, within, like, he's like, we're opening up. The state was like, shut it all down.
Never mind.
I think it was the same week.
Yeah, it was. It was.
Oh, I mean, it was legit right on there. So, like, I've got to give this guy money. Like, I have got, you know, just not in a fry, like, take my money kind of way. But, like, I want this guy to succeed. I need to have that support there.
Yeah.
This is a thing. It's a skirmish game. Worst come to worst, I paint some cool models, I put them in a box, and I never see them again. And I give them away to one of my godsons or my nephews or something like that. So worst come to worst, I do that. So I bought into a the Aussie Arc Bone Arcs. Or
Bone Reapers. Arc, yes,
that's fine. Bone Reapers, yes.
Yeah. So you're the boners.
They're part of Nagash's army. Not that I've studied the lore for a while now, but it's fine.
I will say, this is a problem that I had with Rune Wars.
Mm-hmm.
The fantasy is a little too fantasy for me. Like, there's guys whose bellies are busting open with grave worms, and they march around doing grave worm things.
Oh, yeah.
That's only the dwarves for chaos. Thank you very much, sir. That's only Papa
Nurgle. There were demons. I could have played with these Korn demons, but then I was afraid I'd have to listen to Korn while playing, and I didn't want that to happen.
Well, nothing wrong with that. Continue.
So, I mean, it is a very much in that blood for the blood god thing that I mock all the time.
Yeah.
And then I was like, oh, but there's dwarves. I could play dwarves, except they're steampunk dwarves and they fly from Dwarves. I was like, oh, dwarves fly? Oh, man. Sky dwarves? I couldn't do that either.
Well, they're from the realm of metal, too, but we don't have to talk about all that. It's
but
fine.
So, like, once again, I don't know anything about this game, and I don't want to.
Neither do
we. We're not the fifth trooper here. This is the game where there's, like, no good guys, right?
No, that's not true.
I thought in Age of Sigmar there were, like, you could get, like, the actual, like, people of order and whatever, but, like, the Warcry box was just like, we're all degenerates and it's Mad Max high fantasy.
They're drowned elves. I think Ryan's right on this one. I don't know anything about the lore, but I think he might.
But also, Warcry, though, you can use your Age of Sigmar stuff for Warcry and stuff. So it kind of interacts and interchanges. So they released some special Warcry stuff, but it is more like, gotcha. Oh, I have some Age of Sigmar units that I can now, it's like a $10 card pack, which is not bad. It now converts them all to use this whole new game system, because it is a very different system from Age of Sigmar.
And I will say, Will is playing the most Will-like beings possible. He's playing the Ents. So they're not hasty until they get hasty.
It's the tree elves, so the trees ate the elves, and so that's it.
So just play a map with stairs and you'll win. Will's natural enemy.
Will's natural enemy. So you can take a look at our Instagram, where you'll find Tim, myself, and Will painting our Warhammer Warcry models.
That's right. And I've not posted them yet, but it's coming.
You know, I'm also painting my Legion.
I'll tear it down.
I just received a text message as we're recording this that my air station fan system just came in. It's in the door, so I'll go grab it.
Where'd you go?
After the episode. So yeah, we'll do some more paintings. But you can check all that out on the Instagram at STABcast.
Please check out. We need some help there. We need some love there on our social channels, Facebook, Twitter, any place you subscribe to these podcasts. Give us a rating to help our visibility. We're also available on Spotify, if that's your thing. And you can find us wherever better podcasts also post things.
And we are, of course, as much as we talk about it, we are in the Legion Discord. And we are, I believe I'm now washed up. STABcast Tim is my name.
Yes. I think that is actually
back to reasonable expectations.
Yeah, I mean, exactly. When you have Cinderella
STABcast
Hannon.
STABcast Tim, STABcast Will, washed up STABcast Tim. That's fine.
Yeah. You'll
find a step. I will say, this is a story that we didn't tell earlier, but I kind of have to tell it now since we're talking about the Legion Discord. So when you got into Single Eliminations, they brought you into a group of Discord that is only for Single Eliminations.
Yes.
Yeah,
you know, for you to talk and plan and make... Yeah, exactly. Ryan knows nothing of this. But Brett and Tim and I are all there. And then when the first game happened, so the game started playing on a Tuesday, and someone played like Tuesday 10 a.m. for some reason. After the first person lost, they then kicked him from the channel.
Yes.
And it was a very public kicking. Like, we all talked about it, and then there was a GIF,
yes.
And then he was gone.
He's gone.
We're like, oh God, our days are numbered.
Yeah, so, it's just slowly but surely, and just kicking everybody out, which evidently is how they've always done it, but we just wouldn't know because we're not normally that high.
Yeah, we don't know.
We never make it that far.
That's fine. Yeah, it's fine.
In season one, when I made it, that's not how they did it. But that was season one. That was many moons ago. So... I will say that we actually told you these events out of order because Brett actually played his game first on that Wednesday. Then I played Thursday morning, and then Tim played Friday night.
Correct.
So, and Brett also lost, by the way.
Yeah. So, you know, when the enemy of the podcast loses, we celebrated. It was fine. but there was a post from Thrawn, who's been on this podcast. You've heard. He's a very lovely man.
Yep.
But it was one of those like, oh, this man's the devil. Like, he celebrated in our losses. And he's like, goodbye, Brett. Like, kick. Boom. And you just saw his name disappear off the side listing.
Well, the saddest part is not even being kicked. It's being kicked. But it's also, it's when you're still there after someone else is gone. And you'll go to talk to them. And they're like, no, anymore. They're gone. What, already? They're already gone? Yes. I was kicked from the chat before we wrapped up the post-game interview.
Yeah, it was great.
In fact, with Tim's, it was so much so that I had an inside informant, another Australian man. He gave me the screenshots of Thrawn taunting Tim. Like, Tim's got 30 minutes left in his game. He's clearly losing, but he's got 30 minutes left in his game. And Thrawn is like, tick-tock, Tim.
Not wrong.
So I was hoping, since I lost at 9:30 in the morning, that it would take a little bit more time before Thrawn was awake. Oh no, he was there and had been watching.
He's always there.
So before I decided to actually, you know, concede the game and call it a day on it, I made sure I posted my farewell gift to the chat before I got kicked.
I had mine saved because I knew Thrawn was going to be waiting to just 86 me as soon as I lost. So I had mine copied and ready to paste as soon as it was time. I was like, all right, it happened. Here we go.
Yeah, I think I did the one from The Matrix, not like this. Not like this.
Mine was Doctor Who. I don't want to go.
It was quite sad. It's also like, people really...
It's the begging of, please don't do it. No, please.
So speaking of places we don't want to go.
Oh, God.
We got a new Padme card, and Will's not here to talk about it. So
the news!
We have to.
The news!
Yeah.
Oh, I think Tim, you and I are talking, we're chatting. Again, it's summertime. I've got a little bit of break. It's like 10:30 in the morning. And I'm like, so when do we get the angry rant from Ryan? And Tim's response was, as soon as Ryan wakes up.
Yep.
And sure enough, like 30 minutes later, what the? So let's actually go talk about the card first before we get there. Let's go talk about the card first.
I don't wanna.
Which is already in Tabletop Admiral. Well done, Tabletop Admiral.
Oh yeah, they're on the ball here. Oh, man, aggressive negotiations is this 2-pip. When Padme Amidala issues an order to a trooper unit, it may either perform a speed 1 move or gain 1 aim, dodge, or surge token. It issues to Padme and to a trooper, but Padme, because she's Padme, can issue to somebody else.
Correct,
yeah. So she can actually issue that to two troopers.
Which, again, now, listeners, that might not sound amazing, but remember, with clones, that's anybody's. So it's merely like your whole army now has two of those, whatever your chosen tokens are. Or if you needed to move, you get a free move, and with tactical, you get a free aim. There you go.
Yeah. So, yep. Green tokens, as far as the eye can see.
Right.
Ryan, why do you hate this card?
Remember earlier when we were talking about power creep, guys? Remember how Leia, who is the exact same cost as Padme and doesn't have nearly the cool keywords that she does, has a card in it where her 2-pip is just everyone can just, you order 2 troopers and they can take a speed 1 move? Well, this is that. Except with a lot more freedom, less restrictions, and more options. It's just better in every single conceivable way.
Because Padme doesn't have to order a trooper. If she orders herself, then she can then bounce that to anybody else. Like, it can really...
you can bounce it to a tank? I thought it had to go to another trooper. Okay.
Maybe I'm wrong. I don't think I am.
Nope, it's friendly unit. Yep,
just friendly,
it's
just better.
Unit. Yeah.
But you only get the special ability, though, if it orders a trooper.
Because I definitely am going to have to...
When Padme Anomala issues an order to a trooper unit.
Yes.
So if you do decide to bounce it to your saber tank, you don't get the speed 1 move or you don't get the tokens. But
right.
Still.
Like...
Flexibility.
She's just Padme, or she's just Leia, but a million times better for the exact same point cost, and it makes my heart sad.
It's because Leia's genes are, weeded down with that Anakin stuff. Like, it's just that's
right.
Ruins everything.
That's right.
I mean, I guess Leia's just... got Inspire 2, which is not to be slept on.
Yeah.
And Take Cover 2 instead of Quick Thinking. But Quick Thinking for the clones is actually better than Take Cover. So...
Because everyone gets to use it.
Yeah. And you have an option whether you choose to take it or not for a better gun. But this card is just really strong.
Yeah.
Really, really strong.
Really good.
Yeah. Is it her best card?
I mean...
Maybe?
I don't know.
Reliable's really good. Yeah.
Especially because she gets to share those tokens out at a bigger range.
Right.
Yep.
Reliable's awfully good. And if you really want to play the Secret Mission game, you can. Her 3-pip. I mean, Secret Mission, Infiltrate, then GTFO. Using her 2-pip to run away.
Mm-hmm.
It's a thing that's doable. Yeah. I don't know that her 1-pip is that great, but in a, if you're in a really bad place,
But here's the other cool thing about 1-pips. And I don't know if clones are going to go this direction to where we kind of start to get character and operative heavy, where you're running double commander, double operative. I don't think we will. But those one pip choices for your operatives, with the exception of Sabine, can get cut a lot of times.
Right.
Like, it's the easiest one that you really want your big heavy hitter commander 1-pips. And if you're in a place where you're going to be taking, you have 3 choices of unique 1-pips, it can get a little dicey there. So that's an easy one to cut. But even then, just getting a bunch of dodge tokens that everyone can spend, I'm not even willing to say that card is weak. It clears suppression, kind of like an Inspire would, but it takes it on her. And then she gets tokens that anyone can use. So that's pretty bonkers good.
And you transfer any number of tokens.
Yeah.
So if I've got 6,
it's quite good.
You can just offload those in other places. Yeah. Or save a couple for the danger sense if you just happen to really want it. I mean, I know I hate to talk about power creep. I do. I like to think that FFG doesn't do that.
But this is just a blatant example of it. Yeah.
Because she has the exact same cost. She has the exact same style of weapon. It's the same range. She doesn't get surge crit.
Right.
Woo!
She
doesn't have sharpshooter, but for 5 points, you get her a really nice gun.
Mm-hmm.
That red-white gun at range 1-3 isn't terrible, because you really don't want to take a lot of shots with her anyway.
Right.
And she's sharpshooter 2. Padme Amidala is sharpshooter 2.
Yep.
On top of all that.
Yep. Yeah, so it's the pretty gross. Once again, we'll see what the end of the year points errata does.
Yeah,
if we ever get it, ever happens.
We'll see.
Does Leia drop to 80 points and I'm a happy man?
I do have a written statement from Wilhelm on the nature of Padme's 2-pip. I will read it as so. Ha 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 ha. Well, it just keeps going on like this a little bit longer.
Carries on.
Just carries on. Ha, ha. Second page. Ha, 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 ha.
Yeah.
Sincerely, William Jefferson LePetitMain. So,
okay.
So, we there we got that going for us. Thing that, because we always worried about this in X-Wing, but they did something in X-Wing this past year, and they started doing it with Legion, is the card pack.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it may be that we will get a card pack upgrade for older commanders or older cards.
Maybe. We'll see.
Right.
Yeah, we'll see. We may get to that place where we're like, oh, well, here's actually a better version of this, or here's a more updated one. Or
well, the other cool thing I want to say X-Wing did it too is they started selecting promo cards that had got errated for your local play night events. So like when you go play your monthly kit at your store, the promo cards are the stuff that have gotten some of the biggest or more complicated reworks.
Right.
So to get those cards to those players' hands.
One of the reasons I got a clone box was because it fixed key positions.
Yeah. Yeah.
The updated one is in the clone box.
That's right.
So. The dark days.
So Ryan's rage is all there. And here's the thing. Because of the COVID, we kind of talked about this. This box already exists in the wild in Poland. Yep. I don't know why Poland get these boxes early. I don't know if they're breaking street date. I don't know if they're importing it from the Russians. But the box is actually already out there. That and Cad Bane. Like, it's already – people are buying them. It actually has a really nice box redesign. It's smaller.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like smaller.
I've never understood why these boxes have been so tiny. Yeah.
Huh.
And I guess – yeah, it's actually a smaller box in width size. You can pack more in there. The cards all fit the same. I mean, yeah, the sprues are all in there correctly. Like, it looks really good. And there's lots of modeling options for her.
Yeah.
So that's always nice.
Yeah, it's neat. I'm not going to – don't have too much to say about the box shape of that doesn't really impact our play all that much.
That's all you.
But that's neat.
I mean, it's nice. I guess. It's nice to see those kind of, you know, it's a lifestyle change. It'll help put more units on the shelf for retailers. It will. Because you don't have to take as much peg space for the giant boxes that exist.
We do have some actual cool news, though.
We do. Well, it came from really bad news. This is why we're going to talk about this now. Nova Open has been canceled.
Yep.
So Origins down. That means that should have been happening this weekend.
Yeah.
Gen Con is down. Nova's down. So we're looking at the next major event is maybe Warfare Weekend in November.
They did not get a, from my understanding, I mean, I haven't heard anything about a grand championship. So I'm thinking that our next big grand championship might be the last big grand championship we had last year, which was LVO.
That's right. I mean, hooray. Yeah. LVO reigning supreme.
Since I'm not going to Gen Con, and like I said, I didn't go to work. Like, I'm missing all these events. I think I'm going to try to make sure I make it out to
Las Vegas. You should do it. It's worth it.
Yeah. I mean, COVID dependent.
As always.
Well, depending on where we're at in the world, come January, 30th, 28th, or whatever it is.
Yeah.
There's going to be the LVO. But we have, other than just LVO, I get to run the narrative event at LVO. And that's gonna be a lot of fun. Me and Ben stayed up till like 3 o'clock in the morning the other night working on some stuff for it. It's gonna be an escalation narrative event. I don't wanna say too much about what it's gonna be like because we're still gonna play test it, and I don't wanna tell you there's gonna be something there that's
broken. You gotta get rid of that.
But yeah, it's gonna be four rounds. We're gonna change some things pretty heavily, and it's gonna marry my intention is for it to marry a fun narrative Legion event with a mega game experience. And if you've never played a mega game, you can go back and we did an episode, our post Gen Con episode.
Oh, rip. We would have had another one of those.
Yeah, I know. Where we talk about our experiences with mega games and how much fun that they are. And so there's going to be some.
And I played a mega game a couple of weeks ago online, the Discord version, which I had a lot of fun in.
So. Yes.
Oh, I had a blast in. Yeah. Mostly because I got to make Tim uber mad.
Only because of your divisiveness. And your rebellion. Yeah,
it was great.
You actually
Ryan managed to break the game.
I was gonna say you broke the game, and somehow that's an achievement for you. Most people see that as a bad thing, but you're sadistic enough that it's a good thing. But that's fine.
I mean, they told me to do a thing, and I did the thing, and then they got mad at me when I did the thing.
No, that's your perception of it, but okay.
Yeah, I'm siding with Tim on this one. But it's fine.
come hang out. Come play the narrative event. As of right now, sadly, it is going to be Galactic Civil War only. We may try to have something in place for Clone Wars players. But what we are intending to do and the information that I have, I don't think we'll have quite enough unit variety, to really make the Clone Wars really flourish. But it's going to be a fun event. That's what I got to say. Ben, what are you kind of stoked? Because the plan is right now that you're going to kind of be helping me build this thing. So.
Yeah, so right now, I mean, because Ryan and I had great conversation about our mega games. He and I played three last Gen Con. We played this one online. We talked to Tim about his experience. Yeah. I've had good experience with it.
Oh, yeah.
And as a theater teacher, a lot of what I do for our theater games is kind of mega game-esque.
Right.
We're all big Fiasco players. Like, we love the role play that comes in that and is often sometimes randomly assigned to you. This is a thing that happened. Well, here we go. So I like the narrative idea. I really do. When Legion started, I was already looking for a way to do Imperial Assault on a bigger table with that narrative thrust.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And sometimes we will, when playing each other, go for the cinematic moment, even though we know it's not the game moment. Now, in a tournament, we'll play the game. In a tournament, we play the game. But, you know, casual nights is often sometimes us going for, honestly, shooting R2-D2 from a stab from far away. That's the cinematic moment. Done. Click. Yeah. I love it. When you roll that rally die like Ryan's incredibly improbable dice head win, it's super cinematic. And it is cinematic for the Rebels that live on hope and it pay off. Most of the time, they fail. But that one time. So I like the idea of the narrative. I like what we've kind of started in our planning position.
Yeah, I'm really excited for it.
If it sounds like we're giving you a teaser, we are, because I can't we can't tell you much about it. We've got
we're going to be doing some playtests over the next couple of. I'm hoping to start playtesting maybe the end of July, and I will be doing some both at our local store and on TTS. And so, if that sounds like something you might want to try out, so definitely drop me an email.
Yeah,
and I can add you to that roster.
That's fair.
Yeah, it's gonna be a lot of fun. We're getting very ambitious. The narrative event will have a bunch of open tables on Saturday to play. So this is going to be even bigger than last year's narrative event if you were there. And it's going to be very different from that event, I think, in a way, too. Instead of just having judges running around whose job is to mess with you, which was a lot of fun to do.
Right.
It's going to be a little bit more structured.
I will say in a digital format that Ryan and I looked a little bit like Charlie Day last night. Like, we had a map and we had some ribbon and there's some writing. And there was I had some sticky notes, and there was a board, and then we had to put the things in a spreadsheet so we could see each other. And like, wait, that's not what I said. That's exactly what you said. It's what I wrote down the sticky note. So that's how. At 3:30, when we finally called it quits.
Yep. But it's going to be fun. I'm super excited for it.
So, we return now to the Red Player's Dilemma. You've chosen an 800-point list because you're like Tim and you don't believe in the bid system.
That's right.
Or you're like me and I just, I want to spend all those points. I do. I like the things I get to put into a list when I'm the robots. And 6 points is an extra body.
That's right.
So
exactly right.
But because of the heart of the cards or poor decisions on your part, you have gotten this setup. Hostage exchange. Danger close. War weary.
Yay.
Gross.
And I'll be real honest.
Ever choose this.
This was actually nearly my Invader League single elimination game. I got very lucky with War weary being column one, because it had been column three, my opponent pushes for it. Because as a CIS player, I don't want to see that. It is the hardest thing for me. I can't physically put all my models within range one, I think. Like, I think there's a certain point that just you can't do it. It is very hard for me. War weary is one of those. Because of my leader component right now, is a difficult card for me to get.
Just play Jigu, man.
He's fine. Well, I think he also just dies there. So the real question is, how do you play that? I mean, that's a hostage exchange, danger close means you're very close to the center.
You play it bravely.
I mean, so, is it just two balls running towards each other because you've got to stay within your you know?
I think some interesting things happen here. I think you really want to see this list now that I'm really sitting down and looking at it. This is going to help the Tim style, like double mortar, all the suppressive.
Yeah.
Because if you can't, if you have a really high likelihood of making that that trooper unit that's holding the hostage drop it, and there could be, I think this is probably the most possibility we have of people dropping hostages within the first couple of turns, because there's not like it's not like limited viz where they have a little bit of safety. Obviously, they're not going to get shot turn one. But if you can position up on them, and can you get your commander with danger close, you might be able to get your commander to range one after turn two.
Yeah.
So if you can activate your commander before your hostage carrier.
Right.
But then you're playing out of all kinds of position. You're in a really weird spot. This game's going to go really gross.
Yeah.
Really, really gross.
Well, and
I will say, normally your hostage gets one extra hope.
Right.
They do.
Right.
So you've got that bravery bubble.
So it's helpful.
And you can't get shot on turn one. So you're at least going to have till turn two before you start getting shot. Mm-hmm. So if you go early enough with your hostage carrier group, you'll be okay. It'll be round three where things are going to get real tricky.
Yeah.
No, I was just going to say, and War Weary is one I think people don't always understand. They think of it as a hostile environment, and they don't understand mm-hmm. how huge of an impact. It's not just like, oh, I got a couple extra suppression. Mm-hmm. It's, no, I mean, if you're just a one courage unit, two and you're gone. two suppression and you're panicked.
If you're not within range one, if some part of your cohesion is not within range one of your leader,
right.
you've panicked.
Right.
And that bubble gets so tight there. Yeah. Like, it is so very gross.
So it's a lot smaller than you think it is.
Well, and the other interesting thing is to bring this danger close element into it. Danger close holds such weird real estate, and you can really spread yourself out. It, like, it gives you a lot of options of you really have three big places that you can ball up in danger close if you really want to.
Right.
Or you can spread yourself out. And for hostage, you're probably going to line up, kind of ball up towards the middle. But it's got so much real estate to work with. A lot of weird shenanigans could really happen. But I almost feel like this turns into a game where we're only going to use the middle third of the map.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree.
In my experience, that's almost exactly what happened.
Yep.
I put vehicles on the outside edges because they move fast enough to get mm-hmm. into the center. But most of the play was in the middle third.
Yeah. So the only objective that I've played on Danger Close so far is Payload. And it's wonky on Danger Close, to say the least.
You should play Breakthrough on it. It's even better. It's great.
Well, because Danger Close, like, based on where they put their payload at, and you get to pick its destination, you can do some really weird stuff. But Hostage Exchange, like, it's honestly, it's not, I guess it's the same walk that Battle Lines would be,
right.
Or Major Offensive. So that's interesting. That's really interesting.
Yeah. It's, I like it. It'd be intriguing. Again, that hostage having that extra bravery is actually, oddly enough, is a game changer, right? Like, that's the real mm-hmm. kick.
Yeah.
Is if it's got on a one courage unit, suddenly it's got two courage. Trying to figure out how you're going to play that with nominating your hostage. Because obviously you would know this all before you nominate who your hostage is. So that's right. going to really change, you know, from going, like, put it on a throwaway unit to you might put it on one of your heavy hitters to try and get some more action economy out of them.
And don't get me wrong, I chose this week, but partially because I did have to play it. Like, that was the red mm-hmm. player dilemma I got into. And it was very much, I had to use my B2s only to carry my hostages.
Yeah.
Because they had three bravery, they had the armor, they had the extra hit points. So they took a ton of shots to the face by lots of units. I never shot with them.
Yep.
It's a real bad thing to be at range one and have a great shot on Rex.
And not take it.
And be like, I can't take it because I have to get the F out of here.
That's right.
To make sure that I survive it.
That's right.
It was a hard decision because part of me is like, you know what? I'm just going to shoot him. I'm just going to shoot him and call it a day.
That's right.
Yeah, it's a real hard one. I mean...
Yeah, this would be interesting because, like, you get that scout move with your opponent's hostage, right? Where you get to make a move after you place it. So normally you typically will bring your hostage almost straight back to your long edge. So they have to kind of walk further. But at this point, you probably want to walk their unit towards, but you could walk it towards your armpit where your corner that wraps mm-hmm. around is. And deploy in both of your zones on the long edge on opposite ends and really try to envelop that unit so it physically can't run away.
Yeah.
You could within just a couple of moves on the first two turns, completely encircle that hostage.
Oh, yeah.
This is a great thing for vehicles. Like, this setup is actually really nice for vehicles because they don't care about war weariness.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't care to
set up really strong flanks. Yeah.
Or honestly, not to be silly, but a Dewback don't hate this because, hey, you got two courage. If you put endurance on it, like you should, then you're just dropping suppression anyway. So it's not the end of the world.
I think Rebels would actually really like this because of the Inspire that you tend to have on your multiple commanders and your operatives.
Right.
Well, it's funny because Inspire is actually, it's not everywhere you think it would be now. Like the last couple Rebel like commander releases, we really haven't seen it. Cassian doesn't have it. Sabine has it in a weird way. Like, and Leia's kind of fallen out of favor, and she's usually your Inspire machine. Op Luke doesn't have it unless you take Hope, which, let's be real honest, you're not.
Yeah.
If
you're going to be the blue player in this case,
yeah.
I mean, and Rebels tend to be the one with the bids, this is a pretty good place to mess with your opponent and take Leia knowing that. Because with her bombardment, if you do that on turn one, you're starting the game with suppression in a place where they may be outside that bubble.
Yeah, I mean, I was kind of sitting here thinking about that. Can, with the inclusion of War Weary, can we go back to
to a Leia list where, you know, you bid aggressively and you take hostile environment, you take war weary. I guess minefield would be the other condition that that really forces suppression on the board.
But you can't have that and war weary.
No, but you just build a battle deck around
making
taking as much suppression as possible and making your opponent kind of deal with it.
Yep.
Tim, I want you to put your hands over your ears. This setup, this Red Player's Dilemma, that could be a Han Solo dream. Because Han Solo can rush in there.
The only Han Solo dream that belongs there is a Han Solo nightmare. Because there is no dreams of Han Solo. That's it. Only nightmares.
I mean, because Han Solo is going to, you know, gunslinger anything that comes at him in the middle. Now, he's probably going to die. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah,
but he's going to be the person that's going to get your... He's going to be the person that's going to allow you to escort that troop out.
I think Han's pretty solid on danger close, especially if your opponent misdeploys. But also I think Han Solo is probably pretty good. And this is the first time I really had to think about this on hostage exchange. On keeping up with that hostage carrier and anyone that tries to come rescue it.
Because to be honest, if your hostage carrier dies, which sometimes you kind of hope for, then Han Solo picks it up and just GTFOs.
Ugh, I hate that. Yeah. I hate the idea of that. Yeah. It's gross. Han Solo has no place in anyone's list. He shouldn't be anywhere on the table. Get him out of here.
I mean, he's really not, so.
Good. I mean, my objective is
my
complete.
Secret plan, had my Grievous not taken 6 wounds in the first turn, my secret plan was Grievous was going to pick up that hostage and then he was just going to live. That was the plan. I wasn't going to send him in the center. We were just going to have to fight him, make sure R2 died, and then try to survive on points.
Yeah, that's fair.
That's not what happened. But, you know, that was my plan for it. But I'll be honest, I don't think this impacts clones at all. Again, Will's not going to talk about it. But
yeah.
It's not huge.
I mean, they're almost always within range one.
That's right.
Whatever.
Your clone ball is going to clone ball.
Phase twos have 2 courage anyway, don't they?
Yes, they do.
About that?
Yes, they do.
I mean, because, you know.
And arcs. Arcs have 2 courage.
Arcs have 2 courage. So, in fact, I want to say when we were talking about that list you were playing against Tim, I think they all had 2 courage.
Yeah.
Because Rex had 2. He didn't have, but I think, a single phase 1. R2-D2's got 2 courage. Like, they all had 2 courage. Like, a suppression list isn't viable against that, unless to knock out standbys against the clone ball.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know that they care.
Yeah.
You know who else, speaking of Han Solo, because they actually tend to like the same types of maps, you know who else really likes this?
No, don't say it.
Who do you think I'm going to say, Tim?
Probably R2-D2.
No.
Oh. Beers?
I do not want to play Palpatine against this.
Good call.
Yeah.
Oh, that is so gross. You are absolutely right.
Yeah.
That Palp, was that a 2-pip? It's been so long since I played Palp.
The Palpatine 2-pip that can add a bunch of suppression real early. But just the danger close, you've got a shorter rush distance, unless you're going all the way across the map. Hostage exchange, you can't attack that hostage first turn, but then Palpatine's going to attack the hostage on turn 2, and then he's going to pull the strings on somebody else to do it, and now you don't have a hostage carrier. And his weapon is suppressive, and he's got a command card that hands out suppression. He's typically flanked by units that also give out suppression.
And he's got 4 native courage.
And he's got the best courage bubble in the game for a commander.
Yep.
Well, other than Vader, but yeah.
I'll go out on a limb, and I think it's better than Vader's.
Oof.
Because he gets cover from it. Well, how many times is someone gonna flub that much of a rally roll?
Have you seen my games?
Have you panicked a unit with 8 suppression still on it?
I've seen
this has happened to Grievous quite a bit.
I was gonna say, I've seen this on Grievous.
Man, give in to your anger. You're right. Yeah. Palpatine absolutely would love this thing, provided you can keep him alive towards the center.
Yeah.
Which, if you're playing Palp, you've got tricks to keep him alive.
Maybe.
But honestly, if you do Palp if you just say, I'm not going to use and now you will die, Palp on a range line on this setup, let all the mortars do all the suppressive things.
Yep.
Yeah.
Oh, gross. Royal Guards are the ones who are going to be your carriers.
You double move Palp turn 1 just to get nearby, and then you attack. And, you know, because they're so slow there. The hostage carrier is the same speed as you.
That's right. Dang skippy.
I mean, whew.
So, yeah, Palp could be real, real gross here.
Mm-hmm.
Gross. I kind of like the idea of giving snowtroopers as your hostage carrier, though. just because you
they're probably the best hostage carriers in the game. Absolutely, by a good country mile.
Hey, it'd be even better once they get some extra people to help them out. Like, I don't know, like Gideon.
Before I'm triggered, we're gonna end the show. Thanks for listening. Nope, we're not going there.
That'll be great.
Dark place.
Our time is coming.
Thanks for spending your commute, drive time, paint time, you know, whatever it is you find time to listen to us. And until next time, I'm Ryan Slowoski, and I'm reminding you that those units that Tim's alluring to don't exist yet.
I'm Tim Hannon, reminding you to kill R2 no matter what.
Oh, but Tim, that was my thing. I'm Ben Fowler, reminding you that if R2 is dead, he can't score those points. And it's so worth it.
If you can kill him. And sometimes you just can't.
Every time I kill him. Every time.
Have a good night, everybody.
Good night, everybody. you're jumping way over, buddy. I got nine more things to talk about, buddy. Come on, get back here. What?
Sorry, you took a 30-minute battle report, Tim.
Yeah, you did do a 30-minute battle report, Tim. Like, that was you.
It was 20 minutes. I timed it.
No, it was not. It was 28 minutes.
That's not true.
That was.